Chapter 1, Where We've Been. Originally the School of Crafts, established in 1972, the Cape Breton Center for Craft and Design wasn't always housed in a state-of-the-art facility. In the early days, space, staff, and services were much more minimalistic. Yet with a staff of two, limited equipment, and even more limited funds, the vision to see the craft sector grow, develop, and evolve to a point where it is a significant contributor to the island's economic and cultural infrastructure was always front and foremost. After numerous studies of the craft sector had been undertaken, in 2003, ECBC provided the leadership by funding a research study as to the viability of the island's craft sector, which resulted in the development of a craft sector strategy to guide the growth of the industry. The implementation of this strategy marked the official start of the center's foray into professional development programs, and a framework for progress was forged. A couple of years later, a few staff more and several new projects under our belts, including exhibitions highlighting Cape Breton artisans, regional centers of excellence, and our highly touted artisan trail map, it was becoming increasingly more evident that as our programs and services were developing, as we were moving the craft sector strategy forward, the industry had the potential to have a real impact upon tourism. As a result, the board of directors and staff seized the opportunity to build a cultural facility and a tourism destination in the downtown core of Sydney where we could properly showcase and promote our artisans. With the support of the federal, provincial, and municipal governments and regional development agencies, the center was given the green light to move forward with the building of a new facility. A capital campaign was launched to see the project through, and with the help of support of our donors, community leaders, friends and members, you, within 2 years, the vision for a new home for the Cape Breton Center for Craft and Design was realized. Chapter 2, What We've Been Up To. So what's changed at the Center for Craft and Design since the opening of the doors to our new home in 2007? It's difficult to know where to start. The new facility is a constant hub of activity. There is much afoot, so perhaps it's best to start from the ground up. The first floor of our new facility has state-of-the-art studios where the center hosts courses and workshops year-round. Everyone from community participates, to our professional artisans and visiting tourists have participated in our programs. The new facility allows us the opportunity to bring in regionally, nationally, and internationally recognized artists in niche craft market to share their skills with the Cape Breton community. One of our latest workshops, Katazomi, the Art of Japanese Stencil Dyeing, drew students from Oregon, Yukon, Ontario, and many other faraway places such as Gabarus. It's just one example of the cultural and educational benefits the new facility has brought to the island. Guild members meet weekly at the center to work on their quilts, hooked rugs, and knitting and weaving projects. The center is a place for them to meet, chat, and interact creatively with their community. These guilds are tremendous ambassadors for the center, giving their time to demonstrate and engage other members of the community and our many visitors. More space, better equipment, and the support of the local business community have provided enhanced programming for local youth who participate in our March break and culture and heritage camps. We're keen to get youth started in craft at an early age, to carry on the growth and development of heritage and contemporary craft so that the island craft sector and our communities are strong, vibrant, and culturally rich places to grow, live, and work. Moving on up to our second floor, we begin in our main floor gallery, where we host 6 to 8 regional, national, and international exhibitions a year. This is quite a success in its own right. These exhibitions bring the artisans' work to the local community and visitors to our island, providing an opportunity to promote local artisans' work. It also opens us up to external work, ideas, and trends in the art world, which is something we're striving to achieve with the development of our first artist-in-residence program. For 8 weeks this autumn, we have a graduate of NASCAD University, Caitlin Purcell, creating 5 days a week and sharing her work with students, staff, the community, and visitors alike. The gallery shop is also a bit of a feather in our cap. Through it, we can promote the work of over 75 juried professional artisans and help assist artisans in the selling of their works 12 months a year. The gallery and gallery shop have seen over 40,000 people through its doors in the 3 years it's been open. We have the ability to market the artist's work to a wider audience through the development of a corporate gift catalog, bridal registry, and other marketing initiatives. What's important to point out here is that originally we envisioned the gallery space to be a draw for tourists coming to the downtown of Sydney. But what we are realizing is that the local community is embracing it, both the exhibitions and the shop. They're seeing the value of buying local handmade crafts, the importance of supporting the island's creative economy. The opportunities the third floor loft has opened up is a chapter unto itself. The word partnership sums it up best. Originally, the third floor was meant to be leased as commercial space, but after 6 months, the board, in its wisdom, took the chance and decided to make this a truly cultural facility. We have now hosted exhibitions in partnership with the Art Gallery of Nova Scotia. The Cape Breton University Art Gallery bring exhibitions of their permanent work to Sydney's downtown. We have also partnered with NASCAD University to deliver a portfolio development program for high school fine arts students wishing to follow a career in the arts. But this merely scratches the surface of the inner workings of the center. The new facility has given us the ability to say yes to opportunities that come our way, and there's been many. Apart from partnerships with academic institutions, we are also collaborating with organizations and businesses to take our promotion of the craft sector to another level. These include Craft Alliance, Destination Cape Breton, the Celtic Heart of North America Cooperative, the Cape Breton Partnership, Arts Smarts, Arts Reach, Sydney and Area Chamber of Commerce, Junior Chamber International, and the Sydney Downtown Association, to name a few. Without this new facility, these outside partnerships would not have been otherwise possible. We are also thinking outside the box in terms of how we market the center and the craft sector as a whole. From Twitter, Facebook, and Foursquare, we're there. And we're using these tools to get our message out regionally, nationally, and even across the pond. We've also taken a big step and produced 19 artisan videos that capture the skill and talent that goes into a handmade piece of craft. These videos will be viewable from our YouTube channel and every other social media network we can upload to in 2011. On that note, stay tuned for the launch of our brand new website later in the winter. Just one final project to mention. Stay with me now, folks. There's not much more to go. This new facility is 14,000 square feet of space that can be used for any number of things. We've rented our building for public meetings, special events, cocktail parties, and workshops. It's the latter of these ideas that we are now exploring further. Center staff has been working on developing packages that businesses and organizations in the local community can take advantage of. You need to create a team building workshop, or organize a jewelry making party for a stagette, or maybe your hotel is interested in creating a craft package for visiting guests. Well, we can do it. After all, we've got the expertise in-house. Chapter 3, Impact of the Creative Economy. One final note to send you off on. A recent report shows that the economic impact of the creative economy in Nova Scotia totals over 1.2 billion GDP. Which is more than the agricultural, fishing, and forestry industries generate. Over 28,000 people work in the cultural sector, and this includes our island artisans. There is no doubt that Cape Breton's artisans are a factor in this economic bright spot. It's important for all of us to understand the significance that the cultural economy plays in our lives, and that through investment in infrastructure such as this facility and community participation in cultural activities, we all can contribute to the growth and development of a vibrant cultural community. Chapter 4, Where We're Going. Global Domination. 'Cause you woke up in the morning with initiative to move. So